round two, Gilbert, Arizona, the Nest, as the Highland Hawks getting ready to take on the Desert Vista Thunder in this week two matchup. Highland rolling in at 1-0 and Desert Vista at 0-1. Highland coming off a 21-0 defensive shutout in week one against Desert Ridge. And let's go down to the first interview that a third member of our team, Ethan Ryder, has with Sammy Siaki.
We're down on the field here before the game with senior Sammy. You're a defensive end this year. You guys had a 21-0 win last week.
Yep.
How does that feel with 0 points coming into this one?
Very happy. Our defense is on lock. We're going to be on lock the whole entire season.
And this team in particular, last year, 1 point loss. How much does that drive you going into this game?
Oh, that's we want payback. They ain't gonna survive this game.
All right, and for you personally, you got a little bit of Polynesian roots. How does that help you on the field? Does that drive you at all?
Oh, of course. I do everything for my culture, and I just want to represent.
So Sammy down here with the Luscious Locks. He's hard to miss on. Great player for Highland Hawks. They're ready to battle with Desert Vista today. Back up.
And joining me on the broadcast, my color commentator, Ryan Blank. And Ryan, it was a good start for Highland last week. They burst out to a 21-0 lead over Desert Ridge. Now they're coming into another revenge tour game, if you will, against Desert Vista, as this was another team that Highland lost to in the regular season last year on a two-point conversion that was a failed attempt by Highland. So they're looking for a little bit of revenge in week two. How are they going to get it?
Really, last year, Desert Vista was motivated and really carried offensively by a group of seniors, their quarterback Parker Navarro, who had over 290 total yards and four touchdowns last year, then Elijah Irvin, their senior wide receiver, and then you also had senior Tyson Grubbs, who had a 100-yard rushing game as their running back. So they lost a big piece of their offense when you lose those four leaders. But for Highland, the defense is what going to set the tone and carry them in this game, because you saw how terrific they played last week, only allowing 61 total yards of offense for the Jaguars. That was insane.
And if I'm not wrong, only one first down the entire game for Desert Ridge.
It was only actually two first downs, but they only made it into Highland territory once in that game, and that was late in the game with like 2 minutes left, and their starting quarterback wasn't even in.
Well, the most important thing that any good team has to do is beat the teams that they should beat, and this is obviously a much more inexperienced Desert Vista team than last year, the one that finished second in the standings. So Highland, coming into this game, what are your expectations for both offensive and defensive performances tonight?
I'm going to start with the defense here, and I just expect a lot more of the same. Just a lot of stacking the box and focusing on the run, because you got to focus on the run, because they gave up over 300 yards of rushing offense last year against Desert Vista. So they have to put an emphasis against the run. For Highland, on the offensive side of the ball, I think that this is where you're going to see Gage Daly really use his arm and really air it out tonight, because you have a chance to really showcase what you're made of, because the offense, they put up 21 points in the first half, and you only saw Gage throw twice in the second half. Really kind of closed the playbook and didn't want to show anything. Gage had a 71-yard touchdown to Ethan Whitmore for a big score in the first quarter of the game, and you got to see more of that from him, especially before you get into the more gauntlet opponents of this schedule.
So this is going to be another tune-up for the Highland Hawks. They started the season 1-0 last week, and they take on the 0-1 Desert Vista Thunder. Highland in the midnight black, Desert Vista in the gold caps, white shirts, and gray pants. So ball on the tee, cowbell's already rolling from Gilbert, Arizona, and week two of the Highland Hawks football season in 2020 is underway. And a kick towards the corner of the end zone will be fielded and taken out down the near side. Cutting it back is Eamon Allen, and he'll be wrapped up right around the 14-yard line, and that's where we'll get to see the Highland Hawks start their first drive of this night. So you mentioned Gage Daly before this game started. Didn't throw a lot last week, but had a 71-yard bomb to Ethan Whitmore. Do you expect to see him use his arm a little more tonight?
Yeah, I really want to see more of his arm, because the arm talent is there. You saw that with that beautiful 71-yard touchdown to Ethan Whitmore last week. You want to see more of that, even if it's not those deep passes, but slants, crossing routes, post routes, stuff like that.
So there's the first throw of the game. It's a bubble screen to the outside, and this is going to be close to a Highland first down. So Daly throws his first pass of the night, and a good rhythm throw to get Highland started. Cooper Brown checking into the game, and Brown is going to play tight end a lot for the Hawks, plays both offensive and defensive for this Hawks team, coming off an ACL injury in 2019, so it's good to see him back for this Highland team.
Exactly. A big piece of that defense was lost last year, really before the season got started, and it's great to have him back.
So Daly under center for a fresh set of downs, and the toss goes to Davis on the outside, and Davis cuts it back. Flag flies. Davis around the corner. Davis hits second gear. Davis down the sideline inside the 30-yard line. This one may be called back. As let's see what the referees decide. It's going to be holding against Highland. So the big run for Davis is going to get called back. A huge week for Davis, though. The senior running back, number 27, last week against Desert Ridge.
170 yards and a touchdown last week. He was terrific, especially in the second half, as Highland's main objective in that second half, control the clock, don't give the Jaguars any opportunities, and that's what they really used him for. Had 170 yards rushing. He leads now 6A Premier Division, and he's playing very well. And the main thing that you saw from him was his dominance up the middle on the runs. But right there, you saw a great cut outside for the run. But last week, you also saw a lot of penalties on the offensive line, and that looks like it continues again tonight.
It's definitely something that Brock Farrell was disappointed in this team about, was the amount of penalties incurred against Desert Ridge. So Stewart goes in motion, and Daly will toss to the outside. Second completion of the night, and another good rhythm throw to Hunter Stewart, who had only one reception last week, so he's equaled his number on the season.
Yeah, quick out route right there, just trying to get some yards, make it manageable, because that could be a drive-killing penalty right there, especially after a great start on that bubble screen first down.
And definitely we've mentioned that Daly didn't throw a lot, but he was able to tuck and run a lot last week, 10 carries for 59 yards, and had a lot of good plays outside of the pocket. Some highlight reel plays that will definitely go on the recruiting tape, as Daly will hand it on the straight give to Davis on second down. It's going to make it about third and long. So we talk a lot about offenses trying to be on schedule. And because of a holding penalty, that's 10 yards. That puts you off schedule. So now you're in a situation where it's about third down and seven. What's the play call going to be?
Really, this is where you could see a couple crossing routes, some slants, maybe even a deep post route, trying to get that first down, because you don't want that penalty to really kill the drive, because if there was no penalty, Highland has the ball inside the Thunder 30-yard line.
So we're going to get to see Daly's arm again. Watch for Ethan Whitmore, number 84. He caught the long touchdown last week as Daly with a straight drop to the outside for Logan Kingsford, and he makes the catch. Big week for Kingsford last week. He was most certainly Daly's top target, and that's going to be a first down.
Yeah, he led the team in receptions last week, 4 receptions for 42 yards. And I think you see that because Kingsford's the only really experienced wide receiver coming back from last year's team, and you want that connection right away as you work to get the youth and the younger guys settled in.
So Daly already has started perfect through the air. Three down linemen for Desert Vista. They're going to rush only three. Daly goes down the middle. He's got a man in stride. Here's the first touchdown of the game. Gage Daly, 69-yard touchdown pass. And Highland scores on their first drive of the night.
What a terrific pass. Like we said, that arm talent has been there. A great route ran right there and perfect execution. Great throw, and you want to see more of this from Gage Daly. You could see that, because what Brock Farrell has wanted is to get out to an early lead and keep it, not wanting to have to rely on the air and to come back in games, but to end up having a great lead and to mix in the run and the pass very efficiently.
Jackson Ray on to add the extra point, and he does just that. So Highland once again scores on their first drive of the game, just like they did last week, as this team gets off to another fast start. And Desert Vista, we're going to get to see an offense that was shut out last week.
Yeah. You saw their offense only put up 71 yards total. Really struggled through the air and on the ground. And you really saw the absence of, like I said earlier, those four seniors that they lost. And there's going to be that adjustment period losing key pieces of your offense. And it really came and hit them last week. And, you know, you could see a much improved offense in this game. You just have to wait and see, because the progression's going to have to be there at some point for this team to be successful and make a run towards the playoffs.
So we're going to see the sophomore quarterback, Jason Akins, in just a little bit. But we talked to not only Sammy Siaki, but Cam Colomore before the game. And Highland, they were able to shut out Desert Ridge last week. Are you expecting more of the same this week?
Yeah, I really do. Cam Colomore was terrific, led the team with 8 tackles, but some of those tackles were hard hits, really gave them momentum. And the defense did a great job of setting the tone last week, really fueled the offense because they could go their pace, not having to go up pace trying to come back. Let them really set the tone, give the offense their opportunity to go at the speed they wanted to, and it worked out great.
Big kick by Ray. He's going to end up in the end zone over the head of Michael Allison, the return man for the Thunder. So out comes Akins and the Thunder offense, and Cam Colomore, who has led this Highland Hawks defense this season and for much of last season. So first and 10 from the 20-yard line. Not even 2 minutes have gone by in this game, and Highland already up 7-0 on the scoreboard. The Thunder like to spread it out, and the first play of the game, an inside run.
Go down to Ethan for a report.
And let's join Ethan Ryder down on the sidelines with the story.
I'm down here on the field. I talked a little bit to Cannon Booker, just talking about their defensive play. They're talking about a lot of blitz, a lot of checks. There's inevitable a lot of runs from Desert Vista, so they're definitely going to be trying to combat this game.
If Cannon Booker's talking about loading the box, that's something Highland can do really well. They have a really potent front seven attack as Desert Vista tries to go underneath. No dice there.
Yeah, you know that front seven has learned, got the leadership from Cam Colomore and Cooper Brown and even Sammy Siaki. This front seven can really do a great job of winning that battle in the trenches. That's where a game can be won or lost, is at the line of scrimmage, and that's what made the Highland defense so successful, is because they won the battle of really on the defensive side stopping the run and even getting pressure to force some poor throws from Hunter Stewart last week of the Jaguars.
Third down and 5, and the pass to the outside intended for Allison, incomplete. So decision time for head coach Dan Hines in his 19th season here at Desert Vista. He's seen a lot of teams come through. And again, this is a learning experience for this team, which is really young, a lot of underclassmen, but fortunately they've got a very experienced coach. This isn't his first time adjusting to young players.
The best thing to have when you have such a young team is an experienced coach who knows what he's doing and knows what he wants to do. He has his culture set. He's had it set. It's his 19th season, like you said. So having an experienced coach really makes it easier for those youthful players to come in and get ready for gameplay at the varsity level.
Fake. Allison catches it. Rolls around the outside. He's going to pick up the first down. He's going to get a couple more yards. Banged out of bounds at the 45. And already some trickery to get Desert Vista moving.
And you could see that a lot from Desert Vista, because you saw the struggles with the offense last week. If this could give momentum to the offense, you could see more of it throughout the course of the game. Whatever it takes to put up points and to keep up pace with this high-profile offense from Highland, you got to do it.
So the direct snap to Michael Allison, a sophomore running back, had one carry and lost 5 yards on that single rush last week. Is already about tripled that number. And Desert Vista close to Highland's midfield. First down and 10 from their own 45. It'll be kept by Akins going around the right side, but again, Highland swarming to the football just as they did last week. In 5 minutes. As the kick is up and through, it's 14-0 Hawks.
Yeah, Eamon Allen had a great game last year against this Desert Vista team. He recorded 13 tackles and had an interception last year against this team. He's had some success against the Thunder, and that success looks to accumulate into this season as he now records another interception and is looking to be another one of those guys who's a key piece of that defense.
And he's become not just a key piece of the defense, a defensive starter last season, and retains his position at that strong safety level. But, Ryan, he's also taken some snaps on offense this year, so we're going to see Allen on both sides of the ball.
Yeah, we saw that last week at practice, some trickery plays. And last week we saw him in the game take a couple snaps from the wildcat position, and he had a rushing touchdown. And maybe a big reason for it was because of the inexperience that they have at the wide receiver position. They want to fuel that with some experience to get them going. And if that means you see Cooper Brown, you see Eamon Allen on offense, that can really help the whole offense become more dominant as the young players who are coming up from JV or getting that varsity time that they didn't get last year, they're getting that time, but it's going to be that adjustment. There's always that adjustment period, and it helps to have your veteran leadership take over and lead them. Slant routes or the crossing routes, but it gets them in rhythm and ready to go, and that's what's really going to fuel your offense.
So stoppage of play, 6:58 left in this first quarter, and again, Highland starting fast the last 2 weeks. That's going to be something we're going to look for the rest of the season, because this schedule, while only 8 games, does not get any easier for this Hawks team, and they're proving that they can beat up on opponents that are a little more inexperienced than them.
And that's key. There are those games on your schedule that you believe that you should win and have the best chance to win. You've got to make sure that you're taking advantage of that and getting those wins. That's what's really going to help generate confidence and momentum going into those big games, as they're going to have to face Hamilton, who's a very, very good team.
Down in the backfield, another good play by this Highland defense, which has been swarming to the football.
Punts last week. This time they got it done on the first real punt of the game.
You could definitely tell that this special teams unit takes a lot of pride in blocking kicks, as Allison's going to get the carry, and he was just harassed the entire way, as it seemed like every gap was filled by another Hawk, and it's going to make it second down and 5. So did a nice job turning up the field. Allison, a sophomore, 5'9", 170. It seems like you go through this entire Thunder offense, and you go, wow, there are a lot of underclassmen on this team.
And you know, there are those disadvantages for this year, but the future's bright, especially if they can string some wins this season and make a playoff appearance as well. But that was a great play by the Highland defense, because you saw him wanting to go up the middle, force him to cut outside. That's a great job really stacking the box there.
You don't make 19 seasons as a head coach without a history of success. This is certainly a reloading year for this Desert Vista team, but not for the Hawks, as they have looked just impressive on both the offensive and the defensive side of the ball. And once again, they're just not fooled by any sort of trickery except for the fake punt by Desert Vista all night long.
Yeah, the largest gain for Desert Vista in this game was that fake punt. The defense is doing a great job of reading the play. You don't see some NFL teams like this, especially teams that struggle against the run. The run defense from Highland is looking terrific so far.
Got to give the defensive staff a lot of credit. These Highland Hawks defensive players play with a lot of IQ. Blitz up the middle on third down, and the pass to the sideline is going to be ruled a catch, but it's going to make it fourth down inside their own territory again. Down 21-0, 3.5 minutes left in the first quarter. There's still a lot of football to be played, but you get the feeling that this is a drive for Highland where they can put this game on ice with still 3 quarters left.
Yeah, I don't know how you can see this Desert Vista team really playing at their hardest, because right now they're getting their souls crushed on both sides of the ball. Defense is playing great, has a touchdown. Offense, 2 drives, 2 touchdowns. What else can you ask from this Highland team so far?
Here they come after the punt, but this time it's a spiraling kick in the direction of Eamon Allen, who fields it at his own 39. Started left, started right, went back to the left. Brutal stiff arm down the sideline. Flag comes flying in again. So Allen returns it to the 49-yard line of the Thunder. But again, this one might have some negative yardage going against Highland. And they're trotting out right around their own 35-yard line. as we'll send it down to Ethan Ryder down on the sideline. Ethan, what do you have for us?
Yeah, so I was talking to QB coach Bo Riley about just the front guys. That's what he kind of focused on, the offensive lineman. He said it's easy for the quarterback, it's easy for the running back when those guys are doing such a good job, and he hopes it just continues, especially since last week they scored 21 points the whole game. They scored 21 points in the first quarter of this game already with 3 minutes left. So he's just really happy with the front line, and of course Gage has the talent to take advantage of that.
Seems like you give Gage Daly just even a couple seconds to throw the football to get downfield with those progressive reads, and he's going to make you pay.
Yeah, despite the penalties and the rough start for them running the ball, they're doing great with their pass blocks, and it's really paying dividends so far.
They split Daly out. They bunch four wide receivers to the left. They throw that way as Allen throws the pass to Davis, who makes the catch. And Davis going to jart up the field and pick up about 9 yards. So it's going to make it second down and one. And they've shown that they really enjoy having Allen play offensively. It's going to be a first down.
You saw in practice last week, Eamon Allen was taking some snaps where he was making some throws. You saw those trick plays, and it's a great way to keep the defense on their toes, especially when you continue to punch the momentum down the opposing team's throat. This is their opportunity, and they're not going to waste it.
So Daly will be the quarterback on this play, and he'll go back to the air. Stewart, who has the touchdown catch, makes another reception. And just like Kingsford was the top target last week, make Hunter Stewart number 18 Daly's top target tonight.
Yeah, Hunter Stewart had one reception last week. He already has three receptions and a touchdown. He's looking really good so far. And I think seeing Gage Daly spread out to multiple wide receivers makes the offense more dominant because you can't lock in on one guy.
They empty it out. Daly alone in the shotgun with five wide receivers. And Daly will throw an inside screen. Dropped. Looked like Stewart again thought about turning it upfield before he secured the catch.
Yeah, just a simple drop there from Stewart, it looks like, on that play. Got to make sure that you have the ball in your hands before you turn upfield. Got to crawl before you can walk and walk before you run.
And catch before you run, especially as second down and 10, and the run goes to Max Davis, and he bounds through the hole for about 7 or 8 yards on that second down carry.
Again, going up the middle, asserting his physical dominance as he is just running through guys, and his legs don't stop moving. It takes two or three guys to get him down. It takes two guys to get out his legs and then get his momentum up top as well. He has really, really impressed me so far through his ability to just go through defenders and continually gain yards.
Third and short, and Davis is the running back on the right hip of Gage Daly. And he'll get the carry around the left side, runs over a defender, and then a nice form tackle by the Desert Vista defense made by number 24, Tyson Martinez, who's the defensive anchor of this Hawks, or the Thunder defense, I should say. Hawks are going to leave the offense out there for fourth and short. And Daly sprints out, sends a man in motion. Looks like they're going to try and draw them offside. Still 17 seconds left on the play clock. Fourth and one. And Daly will throw. Caught by Kingsford. First down. Kingsford. Oh, what a cut. Logan Kingsford inside the 10. Touchdown, Highland Hawks again. You rarely hear shook him out of his shoes. But Logan Kingsford made a speed cut to the outside that absolutely left his defender, and then he turned on the afterburners to skirt into the end zone. It is 27-0 as Highland has scored four touchdowns in this first quarter, Ryan.
The offense has been terrific, really relying on the air more this game, and that's what I wanted to see, was more showcasing the talent of Gage Daly.
And Ray's 4-for-4 on extra points. Highland is in control for the second straight week. Both teams they lost to last year, the Desert Ridge and Desert Vista combination, they look to be vanquished by an experienced, talented, and well-coached Highland Hawks football team in 2020. One of the score, after one, Highland 28, Desert Vista nothing. But we jumped in about two plays after the second quarter got underway. So it is 3rd and 18 for Desert Vista after a negative play and then a penalty. Highland up on the scoreboard 28-0. If you're just joining us, Highland Hawks have dominated both offensively and defensively tonight. The way they've reached 28 points, three offensive touchdowns, one passing, two passing, one rushing, and an interception return for a touchdown by Eamon Allen. As 3rd and 18, here comes the blitz, thrown across the middle into traffic and somehow not intercepted. That was about by Highland, but Desert Vista able to get back on top of it.
Yeah, it looked like the snap was fumbled by Akins, picked it up, but right as he picked it up, you saw Cooper Brown ready to hit and laid the boomstick right on Akins on that play for another loss, leading to a 3rd and long for this Thunder offense that just can't seem to get anything going despite a great gain on another fake punt.
Well, if he gets a fourth down this time, do you fake again? I mean,
at this point, they might just go for it.
Snap is taken and then immediately under pressure and dragged down for the sack. Is Akins in the Highland defense, continues to dominate, fourth down, and here comes the fake punt.
That's a second sack for this Highland defense this year. A great play. They are continually getting great pressure on every drop back from Akins. This defense is just making it tough for Grubbs, for Allison, and for Akins each drive in this game so far.
So Allen's going to put together a little more conservative attack here. They're going to send one man after the punter, and he got pretty close. Allen retreating back to his own 9, takes a large step back on his own 7, somehow splits defenders, and there goes Allen. Good cutback to the center. Dragged down at the 40-yard line. Flag comes soaring in. Another
season.
The back-to-pass goes Daly on 3rd down. He's got plenty of time to throw, but elects to run. And Daly's going to get outside the pocket and gets slammed to the turf. A form tackle there. And Daly a little bit slow to get up, but he's okay. Flags again go soaring all over the field. And it's going to be against Highland, which is going to make this either 3rd down and really long or 4th down and short. And when you're up 28 and your starting quarterback starts to run outside the pocket and especially takes a hit like that, that's got to make you nervous as a coach.
Yeah, that could be a play where you would say, Gage, that's a play where you would slide after getting the 1st down. You don't want to risk any injury, and if that means sliding, you got to take it. You see more and more quarterbacks who are used to taking hits in college, but in the NFL having to realize, I got to slide. And now you could see Gage, or having Brockfield tell Gage, slide. I don't need you getting hurt, especially when we're up by 28 points in the first half.
I can almost assure you that's going to be the message from Coach Farrell to Gage when he gets over to the sideline, because nothing is going to make you more upset as a coach in a program than losing your star quarterback in week 2 when you're already up 28-0.
Talk about frustration for a coach right there, especially when he could have slid.
So once again, whistles come in, and it's going to be a timeout taken by Highland. So with 7:15 left, the Hawks up. Well, once again, we've been dealing with some spotty connection issues. It's probably the best way to describe what we've been dealing with on the broadcast tonight. There's a sizable crowd here in Gilbert, Arizona. A lot of them wearing masks. But with so many people trying to crowd the internet, inevitably you're going to have difficulties, and that's what we've been experiencing tonight. So we appreciate you bearing with us. But nothing like the broadcast, Ryan Blank. This Highland offense has had 4 bars, 3 bars of Wi-Fi, perfect connection, all night long.
Extremely. They have had four drives out of their five, resulting in touchdowns. It's been terrific. And the one reason they didn't get a touchdown on one drive is penalties killed it. And Gage Daly's been terrific. Only two incompletions in this game. Insane.
Incredible. Here comes the blitz. Throw across the middle. Wow, what a hit. Pile driving the offensive player there.
Another great defensive play. This Highland defense just keeps making play after play after play. And it's really just putting the hurt on Desert Vista. If you can even put more of a hurt than a 35-point lead going into halftime.
Eamon Allen in on the tackle.
He's had a terrific game. Has the interception, pick six, a couple great tackles.
He's thrown the ball. He's one for one tonight passing. Has a touchdown rush last week.
He does it all.
This is Mr. Everything for the Highland Hawks. Right in the face of Akins is Cooper Brown. Ball might have come out at the end of the play as Brown in for yet another sack.
That
last
is his.
Week it was Cullimore. This week it's Cooper Brown.
That's his second or third sack in this game. He has been terrific. This defense missed this guy last year. Now they have him, and he is playing at the top of his game. It is great to see.
So at the end of the first half, Highland up 35-0. Through six quarters this season, Highland has put up 56 points and allowed zero. So just the way you want to lead off the 2020 season. And if you're going in the locker room, your coach Brock Farrell, is there anything you tell your team that you need to improve on?
I don't know. I don't think so. What can you say? Oh, we need to complete that one pass. Out of two? This offense has been extremely dominant. The defense has been terrific. The one thing he can maybe say is, why have we let two fake punt conversions? That's it.
Maybe a few penalties, but yeah. We're going to find out as we go down to the third member of our team, Ethan Ryder, who's standing by with head coach Brock Farrell.
I'm here on the field with Coach Farrell. Coach, a dominant first half, 35-0. What is the key for them so for your team so far?
Well, great defense. I mean, for 2 weeks in a row, you know, we've set the tone and we are more physical, and we are just saying this is how you play defense here at Highland. So that's a big key. And then, you know, our offense started really fast. We hit a couple big plays, and really proud of the kids. They're doing a great job.
You want to step up real fast. So talking about the defense, I mean, there's some big hits right
mm-hmm.
now. I mean, big. What do you think is just going through their mind? Because they were ready last week. They seem even more ready this week. What did you guys do practice-wise to get in this ready?
Yeah, same thing we do every week. You know, we try to balance it between schematic stuff and when to be physical and when not in terms of periods, trying to get – so it's a balance to keep people healthy, but you still got to – you know, it's a violent game. You still got to learn how to play violently. And ever since, you know, I've been here, our kids have been playing physical, so it's great.
And there's 35 points on the board. The offense isn't doing bad. What are you seeing on that side of the ball?
You know, we had one drive where we stalled a little bit, had some penalties. But other than that, what I see is what we've been practicing all week, our kids executed. And when their opportunity came, they made plays. So it's been great.
So good execution. 35-0 here at halftime. Execution from the Highland Hawks. We're here with Coach Farrell. Back up to you guys.
And thank you very much, Ethan. So you hear the words from Coach Brock Farrell, play violently, and that's exactly what Highland did. Both guys, Cooper Brown, Cam Cullimore, if you're an offensive player, you got the football, you got your head on a swivel looking for number one or number nine.
What about number two out there? Eamon Allen as well laid a huge hit right at the line of scrimmage after a little screen pass out into the flat. What can you do? There's a player at each level of the defense. Up front, Cooper Brown. The second level of the linebackers, you've got Cam Cullimore. And then at the back end, got Eamon Allen. And all those guys are making great hits, and they're really using their leadership and their veteran experience to lead and drive this defense into the success they're having.
35-0, the score after one half of play. The Highland Hawks well on their way to a 2-0 start. But this is a very special week in Gilbert, Arizona for this Highland Hawks program as they remember one of their own, Marquise Cooper.
When you were driving up,
Bruce Cooper, Marquise's father, on Wednesday afternoon, as we reflect on the impact that Marquise had on this program and ultimately what Bruce would want Marquise's legacy to be.
What was the first memory or thought that came to your mind driving in the parking lot today?
Driving in the parking lot, it brought back memories of those Friday nights that I would come to the same parking lot to kind of watch Marquise play. You know, working in the sports media, you know, a lot of times I'd have to sneak away from a game that I was at just to try to come and catch some of his games if they weren't our game of the week or whatever. And this is where it became really just such a ritual for my family to come watch Marquise play on the Friday nights, whether the games are being played at Highland or on the road. And yes, this is this place definitely and will always hold a special place in our hearts.
Bruce, I want to ask about the scholarship that Highland provides. What does that mean to you to have that scholarship with Marquise's name?
Wow, you know, when I first heard about this scholarship in Marquise's name to honor his memory, hey, look, I'll be honest, it blew me away. And I stepped on the field, I saw some of the tributes taking place. I was choked up, I was fighting back the tears, and honestly, I was glad I didn't have to speak right away because I wouldn't have made it through. It's special. I mean, to have Highland recognize, remember, and memorialize my son in such a way, it's just a tremendous, tremendous tribute, one that myself, my wife, and my daughter don't take lightly. I mean, it really, really, truly means a lot to us. Marquise's final home game in Seattle. It was the Apple Cup game against Washington State. Tight game. And normally I'm in the press box. I'm out sitting with my wife and my family and relatives for this final home game of his. It is bitter cold. Oh, it's bitter cold. And so Marquise, interception, pick six. And I tell you, it's a memory that just stays with me and stays with me. I even went to a holiday bowl game. He had a fumble recovery and interception. There was a game in El Paso for the Sun Bowl. Drew Brees' hit fumbles. Marquise scoop and score. So it seems like every time I went to a game of his, there was a big play that he made. But the Apple Cup was really special because it's his final game as a collegiate, and my first ever to watch him play in his home stadium, of Husky Stadium. And here he is, he makes a big game clinching play. I'll still watch that every now and again too. You know, we have that clip. So yeah.
When you look at the Highland program today, what do you think about? You've covered a lot of high school football teams that are pretty successful over the years.
Yeah. You know, Mike Reardon was Highland's football coach during Marquise's tenure. They were used to being a playoff team. They were a football power in the state. Could never, ever seem to get that elusive championship trophy. But, I mean, you talk about a perennial playoff team. That was Highland. What a tradition established here. And then it became a period of time when they began to not have the same type of success. Well, Brock Farrell's come here. Brock Farrell has restored the roar, if you will, at Highland High School. The Hawks are soaring high again. You know, the man is a mastermind. He gets the most out of his players. And it's evident they'll run through a brick wall for him. And so the tradition and culture of Highland High School is back where I remember it. able to talk proudly about the school again, able to come out on Friday nights. My wife, that's every Friday night, all she wants to know, did Highland win?
Okay.
You know, she could go on a road trip and she'll call back, you know, oh, we're having a great time. Hey, did Highland win? I mean.
Even to this day.
Oh, yeah. Oh, are you kidding me? And my wife, and it's only, and she know, you know what, now she'll do the same thing for the Washington Huskies, because my son went there. My son played there. He played here. This is where it all started for him. She doesn't forget. Highland is her school.
Highland's done a lot, obviously, to honor the memory of your son. What types of emotions do you feel when you see the scholarship and the locker now? And the other things that the school has done.
Dude, I saw that locker. That locker was unbelievable. I mean, I saw his picture, number. Amen. I took out the phone. I took pictures of it. What a tribute. I mean, it's the first thing you see when you open the door to the locker room. And I'm like, are you kidding me? I just can't tell you how much that just means to me. And I took the picture because I know my it's going to mean something really special to my wife. You know, like a boys' locker room is not a place you're going to see women come into. So I took that picture for him. But it means a lot. I mean, opening the door, that's the first thing I saw. It's the first thing anyone will see walking into the locker room. How special is that?
Ultimately, what would you like Marquise's legacy to be?
You know, I'd love for his legacy to be one in which people remember his friendly demeanor. He was a very affable kid. Everyone talks about the smile that lights up. You know, so more so than what he was able to accomplish as an athlete, what he meant to the student body as a person. You know, and everyone I run into, they always want to talk about his friendly demeanor and his smile. That legacy means more than anything.
eventually, what can we call ourselves? Are we there yet? Are we even close? Give me something better than you just told me.
It's a lot of talk, so I'm here.
Look. Have mercy on me, have mercy on my soul. Don't let my heart turn cold. Have mercy on me, have mercy on my soul. Don't let my heart turn cold. Have mercy on many men. Many, 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 many men. Wish they for me, yeah, I don't cry no more. I don't look to the sky no more. Cause I got it on me. I got it on me. I got it on me. Have mercy on many men. Many, 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 many men. Wish they for me. Yeah, I don't cry no more. I don't look to the sky no more. Cause I got it on me. I got it on me. I got it on me. You go run up if you want. Mercy on me.
Welcome back to Gilbert, Arizona. Jack Johnson, Ryan Blank on the call. 35-0 Highland Hawks on top of the Desert Vista Thunder. Eamon Allen with a long punt return that is once again called back by a penalty on kick return coverage by the Highland Hawks. Only two incompletions all night long for Gage Daly and this Highland Hawk offense. As Daly inside Thunder territory will take the snap, fake to Davis, roll out to his left, and now roll out to his right. Let's see if Daly can make something happen outside the pocket. Gets towards the sidelines and dives down.
Not much you could do on that play there. Really a broken play from the beginning. Everyone was covered in the secondary. Good coverage by the Thunder defense. So he really just had to tuck and run there. And I think Brock Farrell probably told him, just dive down, because he does not need an injury when his team is up 35-0.
Yeah, it's probably an adjustment from a play that we saw earlier in the game in the first half where Daly rolled out left and really tested the defense, took a shot at the end of the play, got tackled hard to the ground. And
he was slow to get up for a minute, but he got up.
Slow to get up, but also just not something you want to do when you're up 28-0 and you already have a history of collarbone injuries, as they'll hand it off to Davis on second down and 8.
This is something you're just going to have to expect, especially when you're up 35-0. You've seen a lot from Gage so far. Just expect Max Davis to really do the brunt of the work in this second half, running it up the middle, really dominating and taking care of the time of possession battle and really just taking it down all the way and really stat padding right now is really what's going to probably be towards the end of the game. But that's probably the outlook for the Highland offense in the second half.
Yeah, Max Davis already with a touchdown carry tonight. And he'll be motioned out into the formation, wide receiver right. Daly all alone in the gun. Takes a snap and looks out towards the far side. The catch is made near the marker, but spun down, maybe a couple inches short of it. And that is Joshua Shanks, who's in on the catch. His first catch of this Highland Hawk season. We're going to be shouting out a lot of wide receivers probably after this drive. It's going to be about the last drive that we're going to see the Highland starters out.
Yeah, you're probably going to see them start going to their young youth there, really bringing the backups, not trying to risk any injuries, and just really trying to run the clock down and get out of here with a victory without any repercussions of injuries or anything like that.
So penalty at the end of the play, and it's going to go against Desert Vista. So Highland going to get some free yardage and move inside the red zone at the 19-yard line. So Daly once again takes a snap, looks to the left, throws a slant to the inside, caught by Whitmore at the 14. He'll be wrapped up.
That's the first time we have called Ethan Whitmore's name tonight. He really hasn't been involved in the offense. That's his first target and first reception of the game.
Second and 3 from the 13-yard line. Daly in the gun. Two wide receivers. And the handoff to Davis through the middle to the outside. Davis cuts it back down inside the 5. Lunges forward. Touchdown. Max Davis.
Great run by Max Davis. Did a great job cutting outside, following his lead blocker there and cutting in and just lunging for the end zone. A great play by Davis there. His second score of the night.
So make it 41-0 Highland Hawks on top of Desert Vista, and Jackson Ray trying to go 6-for-6 on the night.
He's got to lead attempts. The 6A Premier Division and made point after attempts.
And the kick is up and through. So Highland goes down, scores yet another touchdown. And when we looked at the Highland Hawks schedule at the beginning of the season, you saw a lot of tough teams. But you really expected these first two to be a lot more difficult for Highland, and they just haven't been.
Yeah, you expected it to be a close game, especially after losing to these two teams last year. And you're just seeing Highland dominate. And you could maybe see it last week against Desert Ridge because Gage actually played. He didn't get to play against them last year. But this year, it has very been a lopsided game.
So Ray to kick off again. And Allison is the deep man on the far side of the field. And it looks like Grubbs will take this kick return from his own 2 yard line. Starts up the middle and runs into a bunch of Highland defenders at about the 25 yard line. So Desert Vista will come out and we'll see if they bring out any more of the starters or if their night is done down by 6 scores.
Starting running back Allison looks to be in the huddle for the first down.
First and 10 on the 26 for Desert Vista. Thanks again to our Hawks Nest sponsor, Legacy Funeral Home. Legacy Funeral Home takes care of everything you need to celebrate the life.
It appears we may see a new quarterback for the Thunder.
Yeah, Jackson Akins is out, and so bring in a new quarterback for Desert Vista, and we'll see how he does. Pass to the outside to Allison is complete, but for no yardage. And it looks to me like number 12 is going to be the quarterback, Caden Lentz, who is in a quarterback competition with Jackson Akins at the start of the season and ended up being the sophomore 6-1 getting the nod, but now we're going to see the backup Lentz. This job, obviously, when you have quarterback controversy, still very much up in the air in week two. And after the performance that Akins had tonight, throwing into traffic, pick sixes, this may be a chance for Lentz to win it back in these final 6 minutes of the third quarter and subsequent 12 in the fourth. So he's going to have about 18 minutes to prove his case to head coach Dan Hines. Throw the outside. He's 2 for 2, but a wow, good tackle there. Get up, young man. And that's Trejo on the stop.
Another great play by this defense. This defense, no matter who's in, no matter the circumstances, they're going 100% full intensity, and it is contagious to see as momentum just keeps building and building and building. I don't know if you can get any more at this point with the lead that they have and the way that this team is playing.
Third down and 7. And just like Highland only allowing 2 first downs last week, they have allowed just around that number this week. It has been that tough of going for Desert Vista. Throw across the middle, hit his receiver in the hands, but maybe let him a little too far. So an incomplete pass.
Yeah, this could be Lentz's chance to get that starter job, especially with how the offense has struggled so far this season with Akins under center. So this could be the start of a shift in the quarterback play for the Thunder throughout the rest of the season.
Yeah, Ryan, you make a very good point. It's going to be up in the air for who is the starting quarterback going forward for Desert Vista. They're going to go 0-2 on the season to start after a season last year filled with winning, ending up second place in their division standings. One spot higher than Highland, who finished third after losing to Desert Vista 42-41. But as we have learned in 2020, this year is unlike any other, and it's been the same way for Desert Vista. They just don't look anything like the team that has succeeded so many times in the regular season and the postseason.
You know, and I think that we've mentioned the loss of the big group of seniors, but also the effects of COVID-19 affecting the rhythm and the development of the youth.
Well, I mean, you raise a good point, as Highland's going to get the first down run for good yardage again. New quarterback in the game for Highland. Well, knew everybody in the game for Highland, as getting the rush there was Aiden Withers. And Matt Martinez, a 6'2 junior. So he's going to bring a little bit of change of pace, just like Trujillo compliments Davis. Just a little bit different look when you have a quarterback that is a little bit taller, a little bit lengthier. And so for the second straight week, Martinez getting looks, and he'll throw a dart to Braden Dahl, who's going to make the catch for the first down inside Desert Vista territory.
That is Braden Dahl's first catch of the season for a first down right there. Another young guy making his first appearance on varsity so far this season and gets his first career reception as a varsity player.
Yeah, Dahl, one of the more experienced players on this varsity Hawks team. 5'10", 150. Senior number 83 picks up his first catch of the season, and it's a Hawk first down as Martinez will hand it off, going around the left side and trying to cut it back. Lower in the head was with us, and going to get inside the 40-yard line.
Great run by Withis there, cutting outside, then coming back in, gaining those few extra yards. The offense is rolling a little bit, gaining some yards here, despite pulling the starters with Daly and Max Davis. So this could be a nice little preview to what the future holds with the depth that Highland possesses on this roster.
Well, you love to get your reserves some looks early in the season because you never know when the injury bug might bite as Martinez completes another pass across the middle, but a flag flies, and this one may be coming back. We're going to see what the ruling is on the field. Thrown by the line judge at about the 36-yard line, back by the line of scrimmage, and it's going to be against Highland. So yet another penalty for the Hawks offense. And through 2 weeks, although they have dominated their opponents, they have got to stop shooting themselves in the foot.
Yeah, they're really shooting themselves in the foot, like you just said, with some sloppy offensive line play with penalties. But another great play, a great pass by Martinez on that play there for the first down. Another big play taken away by another penalty. And again, I've said it before, this could be a drive-killing penalty at this point.
I mean, you want to ask how good Highland looks this season. Their backup quarterback looks far better than any of the starting quarterbacks for Highland's opponents through 2 weeks this season. It's a handoff to Withis. He's going to get some of the yards back that they lost past the 40-yard line. Martinez has come in, has thrown three passes, completed all three, and he's looked pretty confident and competent in the pocket.
Yeah, his pocket presence is really good. Looks very comfortable going through his progressions, going through the dropbacks. He's looking confident. He doesn't feel nervous, which you would really see from a guy coming in late in the game. So it's nice to see that there is depth at that quarterback position for Coach Farrell and the Hawks.
And Martinez to the air. And he should be 4-for-4, but Withis dropped it. Actually, might have been Max Davis out there to catch.
To me, that looked like number 87, Landon Hahn, who looked like he was in the slot tight end position.
Yeah, that's a good call, Ryan. 87-27. Hard to tell.
Especially with the color jerseys. They kind of blend in.
Yeah, they really do blend in. The numbers are really narrow. But who am I to complain? This is a really clean look for the Highland Hawks. Another drop. Martinez should be 5-for-5 right now, but his receivers are batting the balls down.
Yeah, that looked like it was Crew Horn on that play there with the drop on the outside. That could have been a first down right there for the Hawks. But two drops, so got to make sure that you're catching the ball before you try to run and turn up field.
So they went for it on fourth down. And let's keep in mind that this game should be over a little faster now that the score has reached 42-0. Keep in mind that in Arizona varsity football, any score or lead over 40 points results in the clock running continuously. So Lentz back in the shotgun, sends his man in motion, and here comes the jet sweep for Desert Vista. Not a chance. You can't run up the middle. You can't run between the tackles. You can't run between the guards. You can't run laterally. What do you do against Highland's defense?
What it's really going to have to be is see if you can get a pitch outside, because if you hand off and you're seeing him go outside, the Highland defense just does a terrific job of reading the plays. They're doing a great job, and it's really hurting their any team's chances of getting in a rhythm on the offense, especially running the ball.
So the end of the third quarter, and we'll go down to the field. Ethan Ryder has a report.
I'm down here with transfer tight end Jace Patton. So Jace, transferring over to Highland, got to sit out a couple games.
Yes,
what
sir.
Was that reasoning behind transferring?
It was an environment change for me, at least. I have a lot of friends over here. Like, sports are good. It was just a really good choice for me to make. So.
Yeah, and speaking about that environment.
Yeah.
There seems to be a real good culture around this team. High
yes,
fives,
sir.
Everyone running down,
oh,
celebrating
yeah,
the touchdowns.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about that culture.
Man, we're a family, man. Like, we, like what we got, like, everyone's like here for each other. We all got each other's backs at all times, you know. And that's like what makes a team good. Like, if you have connection with the team, that's how you become a good football team. Cause we got skill, but and we got now we're brothers. So you know, that clicks. So it works.
A little bit of clicking from the Highland Hawks football team. A real good family around here. Looking like they're building something special.
Thank you, Ethan. And just to jump on that point, this is a really good culture with this Highland Hawks team. And a lot of it has to do with the family atmosphere that comes around. But also, this is a school and a program that literally brings a lot of family members through the system. A lot of older brothers passed down to younger brothers, passed down to their younger brothers. There are always about two or three generations of players that come on this Highland team. And that continuity of playing from the younger ranks all the way up to the varsity ranks is what allows Highland to be as successful as they are.
It's the traditions that I think help build that culture. Because when you got an older brother, he's telling you, get ready for Highland football. Get ready for the amazing play and the culture and the family attitude.
You got to love the gang tackling that Highland is able to do defensively. They're shooting gaps. More often than not, they're running with three down linemen, and they're getting penetration into the backfield. And a lot of it has to do with just the discipline that they use in terms of gap control. They never seem to be out of place.
The discipline, especially on that defensive line, is outstanding. Like you said, the gap control, the guys are just going for the ball all at once. It's great to see that play. Every one of them wants to get the ball and wants to make that play, and that's what makes a great defense, the urge to play and make a play.
Cooper Brown has come in the game, and here comes Highland on a blitz. Lentz throws, picked off. Highland's got their second interception of the night at their own 40-yard line.
It actually looks like that Akins was back in and threw that pass. Number 11 was out there throwing that pass.
Well, in that case, it has been a rough night for Jackson Akins.
This could be, this fourth quarter, the rest of the way, you could be seeing Lentz come back out and get his shot, because Akins has just struggled throughout the course of this season so far, and they may need a quarterback change, and maybe that more veteran experience from the junior can help get something going, because the offense just, like Desert Ridges, leaves a lot to be desired.
You're not Dan Hines, but why would you bring out your starting quarterback who has struggled all night long, then return him to the game after your backups performed, honestly, pretty well?
Yeah, I did not understand that, because Lentz did not look bad on that drive. Complete a couple passes, yeah, didn't get big chunks of yards, but completions. That's starting to get him in a rhythm. I don't know why you would pull Lentz, who was trying to get in that rhythm that all quarterbacks need to get in the middle of a game. So doesn't make a ton of sense to me, but this could be a battle. This could be like a preseason-type battle here, especially with the lead that Highland has.
It's a good point that you make about preseason battling, as Martinez rolls out right, looks to throw, got a man, incomplete. Tipped off the top of his fingers and falls incomplete. Martinez got knocked to the ground at the end of the play, but he gets up.
Yeah, and that was, again, Landon Hahn, who has now been targeted twice. He almost came down with a great catch there. I expected Martinez to try to throw that ball away, but he went for Hahn, and he almost had that catch. That would have been a terrific catch as well.
That really would have been a terrific catch, and triple coverage trying to high point the ball. So third down and long, And likely a point we're going to get to see Martinez throw again. And just like you mentioned on that last drive, he looked really good. So we're going to see if Martinez can keep that good momentum rolling. Martinez rolls right, and here comes Desert Vista. He lets this one go near the sideline, incomplete.
Yeah, he looked like he was targeting Rex Hoagie there along the sideline. Just a little bit outside, a little bit overthrown. Looks like even if he would have caught it, it would have been incomplete as the ball was more towards the sideline. But not a bad throw on the run, because you see a lot of high school quarterbacks, they're still trying to develop their ability to throw on the run. And that was not a bad pass, just a little bit overthrown.
So Martinez, not as good as the first drive, but still looked pretty composed.
Yeah, exactly. He looks composed. He doesn't look nervous. He's going through his progressions, doing a great job of seeing the pressure and rolling out.
And Highland is going to send the punt unit out with 8 seconds left in this play clock. So they got to get this one off fast. 2 seconds left in the play clock. And they got to snap this one. Play clock has expired, but referee's content to just let this one go. Ray hits a wobbly one, which will be downed at the Thunder 35-yard line.
This looks like it'll be the best starting position for this Thunder offense throughout the entire game. Who knows if they'll do anything with this position, but they got to get something going, trying to just avoid their second straight shutout.
Well, you open up 42 to nothing, and you think, well, where's the excitement in that? Highland is going for 2 straight shutouts, and with the clock rolling inside of 7 minutes, this is likely the last offensive drive that they're going to have to contend with. So Highland, who opened the season with a 21-0 victory, this defense has not allowed a single point this season. And Ryan, they're definitely aware of that on this drive for Desert Vista.
Oh, yeah. Especially when you're trying to avoid a second straight shot, you're just desperate to get some points on the board.
Hand off to the right side, and that one's not going anywhere. Lentz is back in the game.
Another great play by this defense. They continually get through the line and make constant tackles behind the line of scrimmage. Their tackle for loss so far this season just has to be insanely high. They're doing a great job of breaking through the line, even during the passing plays, because they're getting pressure on any quarterback that they're going against.
Only 3 down linemen, but Highland loves to blitz one of their linebackers. They always like to bring an outside linebacker. Right now, you can see the left outside linebacker on the far side of your screen. And they're coming after Lentz, who throws to the middle. Caught. Good completion to Allison. And he gets knocked into at the 44-yard line and makes it 3rd down and short for the Thunder.
I will say this. The one promising piece that I've seen throughout this entire game for the Thunder offense is Allison, their running back. He's done a solid job running. And he's really doing a great job in the receiving game as well. So he could be a piece for them in the future. And that's really all you can say about highlight players for this offense, because they just have not really done anything.
Yeah, but as you mentioned, a building block possibly for the Thunder offense. Only a sophomore is Michael Allison, as Lentz will hand it off straight through the middle, and that's a good rush for a 1st down. On 3rd down and 3, it's going to get the Thunder up by midfield. So Highland, they've got the B team out there, but they still want the 2nd straight shutout.
Yeah, they are still calling out plays, still going with audibles. They're not just going like that prevent mode like you see. They're going hard, and they are not ready to give up this shutout, and they don't want to.
2 interceptions tonight for this Hawks defense. 1 return for a touchdown by Eamon Allen. In a first quarter that saw Highland put up 28 points. Lentz to the outside, another catch by Allison, and he'll turn it upfield. And Michael Allison, who has been the star tonight for Desert Vista by far, makes yet another reception in the passing game.
Yeah, he's doing a great job in the passing game, getting open in the flat and making just some big chunk plays for them that they haven't really had all game. But you mentioned the 2 turnovers. And I was talking to a coach, defensive coordinator at Gilbert High School. He said, you get 2 more turnovers a game, you'll win 8 out of 12 times.
And Aiken's back in the game, and he makes a good throw. And Allison again makes a catch. Best drive of the game by a country mile tonight.
Yeah, this is the first time they've been in Highland territory, and they're really doing a great job of using Allison to get open, and it's working. This is the first time you're really seeing them put together a drive with constant yardage. But I'm still confused why you're seeing Hines continue to bring in Aikens, then bring in Lentz back and forth, and you're seeing it during the drive as well.
I think what we're seeing is a quarterback competition unfolding right in front of us. So let's see who the quarterback is on this play. It's to throw the outside. It's Aikens with a good throw and a nice catch by Allison, who breaks a tackle, gets inside the five, and scores. Touchdown, Desert Vista, the first touchdown of the season for them and the first touchdown given up by the Hawks all year long.
Another pass out of the flat to Allison there, and he just took advantage of it. Really did a great job cutting outside, running along the sideline, and just using his speed to outpace the Highland defense.
Well, there goes the second straight shutout. And with 3:10 left.
There is nothing against only allowing one score in two games, though.
Hey, you'll take that, especially against two teams that you lost to last year. But that's definitely something that this ultra-competitive Highland team was well aware of on that drive. But you got to give credit to Desert Vista. They were down all night, and they come back on the shoulders of their sophomore wide receiver slash running back, Michael Allison. And Ethan Ryder's got another story down on the sidelines. We'll go down to him now.
I'm down here with cheer coach. This is, of course, a little different. Last week we were away. There wasn't the cheer. There wasn't the marching band. We just heard a tuba turn up. Tell me a little bit about just the noise that's creating at a home game.
It's so much energy that we're getting from this kid. Our student section is absolutely the best in the whole wide world. And we're having a little version of it, but it's just amazing. It's so good to be here with our kids and experience this. It's amazing.
Yeah, how excited is your cheer squad to be back out here?
Oh, my gosh, they're super excited. We worked for this for so long. We waited. I know that it's been kind of difficult times, and we're just trying to make the best out of it, and these girls have worked so hard to be here today. So this is amazing.
Awesome cheer squad out here making a lot of noise, keeping it positive. Back up to you guys.
Thanks, Ethan. Bringing us great stories down from the sideline all night, the third member of our team. And 3:10 left in the game. 42-7. Let's finish up these last 3 minutes and get Highland to 2-0 on the season. Probably the last time we're going to see them tonight. On offense, onside kick, and Desert Vista's got the football. So here comes the 35-point comeback, starting with 3:10 left and all three timeouts.
I will say this. The special teams unit for Hines and this Thunder team has been terrific. Two conversions on fake punts, and now an onside kick. Wow, they're doing a great job. And that's really been the highlight there. The special teams unit and Michael Allison have been the two highlights for the team in this game.
Well, the special teams coordinator for Desert Vista, probably going to be our coach of the night because he's reached deep in that bag of magic tricks. Two fake punts, an onside kick. All three have been successful. And let's see who the quarterback is. It looks like it's going to be Aikens again for Desert Vista. Clock is still running. 2:30 left. Desert Vista tries to make the final score look a little closer than the game actually was. It's Grubbs getting the carry on first down. Or that's Quentin Ivy. My apologies. The 5'6 sophomore running back for Desert Vista.
Another great job of Highland stacking the box, getting right at it, and just gap control. Getting through the gaps and wrapping them up. No team, I don't know if there will be a team that can control Highland's gap control and their defensive front up the middle against the run.
A lot of Ivy last week for the Thunder. 8 carries. I think that was his first one tonight, as getting inside the 35-yard line and another DV first down. And with 1:45 remaining on the game clock, the Thunder in Highland territory again. trying to get their second touchdown of the night.
And this has been the storyline for the Highland defense the past 2 weeks, is that they haven't allowed their opponents to get into their territory until really you see the youth come in and late in games.
Three wide receivers to the left. And Akins takes a snap. A straight handoff to Hughes, who will be wrapped up and slung down at the 27-yard line. Inside of a minute five. Highland is going to advance to 2-0 on the season. They will play Sandra Day O'Connor at home next week. And then you really open up the gauntlet. Teams like Chandler, Hamilton coming up. As the handoff on second down and eight to the left side. Really good run here. Really good run here. Still breaking tackles and finally knocked out of bounds. Well, we're finally getting to see Quentin Ivey. Again, seven carries for 23 yards last week and really hasn't seen much action until this drive.
Yeah, we haven't really seen him run the ball. Thought this was going to be maybe a couple targets here and there throughout the game, but he looks like their best running back right now running the ball, as Allison has been more dominant in the passing game. So you could really see a nice duo there with Allison coming out on those pass catching downs and Ivy running it up the middle on first and second down.
Desert Vista still trying to find their identity on offense. They're so young. As Allison and Ivy, two sophomore running backs, and they're coming in to kick. So 5 seconds left in the game, and they'll call timeout. Timeout, Highland.
Interesting call here.
The only reason Highland would be calling a timeout is this is a sportsmanship move by Brock Farrell to allow DV a chance at a few more points. And with the ball spotted on the 21-yard line, this is going to be a 38-yarder for their kicker.
Now their kicker is Marlon Houck, who is a senior, and looks to make this a closer game.
Our correction, that's going to be Noah Perez kicking, who's a 5'5 junior. And so from the left hash mark, here's a 38-yard attempt from Perez to make the final score 42-10. Good snap. And the kick is long enough. It's good. 42-10 will be the final score tonight from Gilbert. So Desert Vista is shut out through 3.5 quarters, scores 10 unanswered to finish the game. But ultimately that's inconsequential on the scoreboard because Highland dominated this game.
Yeah, they really did. Those points are really, hate to say it, but garbage time points. But I think that's good for them. To see them get in the end zone and get some points is big, especially because they were on the verge of being shut out 2 games in a row. So I think this is big for their offense going forward. But again, Highland dominated this game all the way through. The offense, terrific. The defense, terrific as well. Again, this defense is going to be a problem for any offensive coordinator. And then you've got Gage Daly. You really saw him come out slinging the ball around, only had 2 incompletions. What does a defensive coordinator do? Got Max Davis, who's a powerful runner up the middle, and then you got Gage Daly, who's got a terrific arm. This Highland team is extremely dangerous, and they have proved it, getting revenge against two of the teams that beat them last year.
The problem for coordinators, the question that you posed, Brian, is that offensively, it's really hard to stop Highland. And defensively, through 2 games, it's really easy for Highland to stop you.
Yeah. It's been clearly evident. And I think the best thing that Gage Daly has done, he has not just gone to one receiver constant. Last week, Logan Kingsford. Today, Hunter Stewart. You're seeing him mix in different guys because you see teams when you've got someone, like in the NFL, you got DeAndre Hopkins on the Cardinals. You know to lock in on that guy. Who do you lock in on for this offense for Gage Daly, because he's mixing it up with multiple receivers?
Yeah, he's done a really good job spreading the wealth around offensively. We've seen long touchdowns through 2 weeks. We've seen good passes to the outside, and we've seen good individual play from players like Max Davis. And on the defensive side, who are the guys you want to shout out?
Cooper Brown, a terrific game in the backfield all night long. Terrific game. Cam Colmore made some great plays. A great pass deflection to open up the second half as well. Eamon Allen, how can you not shout him out? An interception, pass deflection, and then that interception returned for a touchdown. Really set the tone early after a Highland score. So this defense, like I said earlier, has guys at each level that are just playing at a high level week in and week out.
So we're going to get Eamon Allen, the star defensively tonight for the Highland Hawks, and he's been the man doing everything tonight. Mr. Everything for the Highland Hawks, and he's down on the field with our own Ethan Ryder.
So I'm here with Eamon Allen, senior. A big night for you on the field, but off the field as well, winning the Marquise Cooper Award. Can you just explain to me how that feels?
It feels amazing. Like, it's a complete honor to know that my coaches love and respect me and believe that I'm such a good man in the heart, and as well as the players. So it means a lot.
And of course, 42-10, you out there making some big plays. I mean, how does that feel for you and the team just moving forward, two statements in a row, as your coach said?
Feels great, you know, great start. This year we're starting out pretty fast every game, but it's nothing, like, this game doesn't matter. We got next week, we got to start the same, strong. Yeah.
And your coach said that you guys need to compare yourselves to us, is what all you guys said, and big unity. There seems to be a really good community, a really good culture around this team. You're a senior now, so how have you guys built this over 4 years or over however long you've been building this?
So it's like respect among players and coaches. No matter the grade level, becoming freshmen, we all welcome each other, and we try to help everybody feel like they have a spot on our team. Even if they're a backup, third string, they have their role.
I'm down here with Eamon Allen, a big day on the field and a big day off of it. Back up to you guys.
Oh, I don't know. I'm sorry. Well, as you mentioned, Ryan, that is a big night, not only on the field but off the field. Eamon Allen, they're awarded earlier tonight the Marquise Cooper Award, a scholarship awarded to a different Highland Hawks player every year in honor of the memory of Marquise Cooper. And we ran that piece at halftime, filmed it on Wednesday, and talking to Bruce Cooper, you just get a good sense of what this program is all about and what they do in terms of honoring the memory of Marquise Cooper. Highland, again, secures a win on Marquise Cooper night. And you can tell it means a lot to the players, coaches, and the staff here at Highland to honor the memory of one of their own.
This night has been very important for this entire community. Every single night, they want to tribute Marquise Cooper for who he was and everything he did. But as Bruce Cooper said to us in his interview, it doesn't matter what he did on the field. Terrific player, just who he was as a person and how he always lit up every room he walked into. And just to see someone like Eamon Allen get that award just speaks to the high level of character and who he is. And it's terrific to see that years after Marquise played here, he still has an effect, an impact on every one of the teams and players.
And of course, Marquise, if he was here, he would be obviously a big supporter of Eamon receiving the award, but he would be a big supporter of the performance on the field tonight by this Highland Hawks team. 42 points, the majority of them coming in the first half.
Yeah.
Offensively and defensively, they really dominated. So looking forward to the rest of the season. They're going to get one more tune-up game next week, but then eventually they're going to reach the gauntlet of the schedule. What are the things they're going to have to keep doing well and things they're going to look to do better as that gauntlet approaches?
You know, you need these wins to give you momentum and get you prepared for these gauntlet matches, especially against Hamilton and Chandler. You got to be ready for these games. These are going to be tough games. Games that you know you want to win and want and have to win to assert yourself as one of the top teams. So just the defense has to keep playing the way they're playing. They're playing terrific football, stopping the run, stopping the pass. They're doing a great job. And the one thing that I think they have to improve on has got to be the offensive line play, and mainly their discipline. Got to eliminate penalties, because those penalties can kill drives, which can kill their chances of winning games.
And once again, down to Ethan Ryder, who's got those big boys lined up next to him.
I'm down here with three offensive linemen, Noah Boone, Cooper Stevens, and Makuapule. And the offensive linemen today were absolutely dominant. So what do you guys feel? I mean, the running backs, the quarterbacks, they had it. How'd it go out there?
It went awesome. We got plenty of pancakes, and it was a lot of fun.
That's just what we do, you know. We come out and we dominate.
Just doing our jobs. It just dominant and Rhoda. That's all I can say.
So, dominating, helping the quarterbacks, helping the quarterbacks. How do you guys build off of this? Two straight, very strong performances. How do you guys, offense, the defense, how does a team grow on this?
You compare yourselves to yourselves, not your opponents. You keep working on yourself, how you can get better. Just better yourself.
Couldn't have said it any better.
So down here with the offensive linemen, big performance from them today. A lot of pancakes, as they said. Back up to you guys.
As you like to say, when the offensive line has a good game, those boys are eating. And they were eating tonight. Noah Boone, Cooper Stevens, and Makuapule. They're not men of many words, but they're men who talk on the field, and they let their games do the talking once again tonight. Ryan, let me get your final thoughts before we check out of here tonight.
Great team win. Great dominant performance. Keep Gage Daly doing what he's doing, throwing the ball. Because like you said earlier, these are tune-up games to get them ready for the gauntlets of Chandler and Hamilton. They're not easy games, but these are games that prepare them for those top teams. And Max Davis has proved that he's got the skills to be dominant running force. Same with Gage Daly through the air. He's been terrific. Keep using the momentum that you have to just put more and more and more pressure on each defense and put some more work on your team. Try to open the playbook more. Give Gage Daly some more reps. I know that there's not much more you can ask of him, but he was terrific tonight as well.
So Highland's going to get the win 42-10 in Week 2 against Desert Vista. They lost three times last season, and as we mentioned, they are 2-0 against the teams they lost to already this year. Just one more revenge game left coming against Hamilton later in the year. But for everyone on this broadcast that has helped put it on, Ryan Blank, our producer Tobias Rain, sideline reporter Ethan Ryder, our cameraman upstairs, and of course Parker Dunn, who has manned the field camera all night long. We'll say so long from Gilbert, Arizona. Tune in next week, 7 p.m. is the kickoff against Sandra Day O'Connor for Week 3. But signing out from Gilbert for Week 2, the Highland Hawks 42-10. I'm Jack Johnson, and we'll see you next week on the Highland Hawks TV Network.